Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, Pro Taper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit protaper.com for more.
Hey everyone, Michael Antonovich with Swapmoto Live, bringing you this episode of the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. It's a three-part episode this week. We got Don on vacation, so me, Chase, and ARay are all across the country. ARay's at the O'Neill office, Chase is at the SML headquarters. I'm at home in Illinois after a great weekend. We were everywhere this weekend, so X Games was up there in Ventura, ARay's neck of the woods. Chase was down at home in SoCal enjoying it, and I was in Southwick, Massachusetts, watching round five of the Pro Motocross Championship, so let's just get into it. How was the weekend, boys?
Dude, I mean, it was action-packed, like you said. I mean, so much going on this past weekend with X Games and then, you know, obviously Southwick. And, it's nuts. We're gearing up for, Red Bud. And then we have some over here on the O'Neill side, we got some kids going over to the Netherlands as well, to represent the USA. So that's awesome. We've been doing stuff like that. And then the whole X Games deal, we had Raha over there it was an awesome weekend, for sure for the guys. Raha got a medal. So that was good. He was silver, which I mean, we would always, want, him to be, in gold, but yeah, I mean, it was still a solid performance from him. I guess a lot of people saw on Instagram, there was some beef, I guess, with him on the start, but I mean, hey, what can you do? I mean, we all seen how, the best whip went with Patrick Evans. Obviously he's on a Stark as well. So maybe, that had something to do with it. But I mean, I talked to the guys, in Southern California who've been riding with Patrick Evans before best whip. And they said it didn't matter what he was on. He was cranking him on his regular bike, on the Stark, everything. So it was insane. I haven't watched it back on TV, but being there in person for best whip, it was nuts. Like, these guys are pushing the limit, with Behrman, Patrick Evans, YO, Jared McNeil, all these dudes, great dudes. I mean, YO, I feel like should have maybe gotten a medal, but I'm not a judge. Right. So, they were all cranking them. I mean, dude, being there in person to see Patrick Evans, he did this gnarly neck whip. And dude, it was insane, completely upside down, his whole body off the bike. And then he was able to just pull it all back together. I'm and he just seemed confident doing it. And I was blown away by what he could do. Yeah. So, I mean, the attendance at X Games, it seemed pretty solid, especially, for best whip. There was a lot of people over there at the end of the night. And then immediately after it was done, everyone rushed over to see Wiz Khalifa. So it was a pretty cool experience. The whole deal, it all went really well. So yeah, it was cool.
Go ahead, Chase. Go ahead.
I was going to say, while we're talking about Patrick, I sent a message to him. I think we're all a little bit jaded just because we're around dirt bikes so often. And it's rare that I get anxiety and butterflies, or just I'm shocked, especially seeing stuff on TV. But dude, every whip, and the fact that he seemed to somewhat better his whips every run, even when it looked like he had it under control, the last whip was ridiculous. Dude, just next level. I can imagine being there in person and seeing it too. Every time I'm like, dude, is he gonna pull it back? And he flicked it right back. Crazy.
Is that something to say for the Stark? Whenever you ride it and you do a jump and you hold the gas, it'll straighten the bike out.
Yeah.
So I'm curious. I mean, people can ride them. People can ride these bikes in these events. So do you think moving forward, we'll see more guys on the Stark?
I think it's an interesting topic too. And if you guys watched the SML show we did with Patrick, he's not running it on 80 horsepower. A lot of people are thinking he's got a power advantage, and it's really a torque advantage. He's running it on 55 horsepower, but it's the instantaneous torque and the no rotating mass in the motor that really allows the rear wheel to control, where the gyro of the bike. Right. And I think that's what I wanted to ask you, kind of how the mood was in the pits on best whip, because leading up to the competition, I seen like Tom P comment a couple things about how like it seems like everyone's gonna have to be on e-bikes for it to be level competition and stuff. So it seemed like there might have been a little bit of hurt feelings from certain riders about it. But like you said, it's there's only a couple riders that are held to manufacture.
They've known all year, you know, that they can show up on a Stark, you know, and they've seen the videos of Patrick that he's been posting on Instagram. If I was another, you know, athlete, you know, doing best whip, if I wanted to compete and I wanted to get a medal, I would have went out and got a Stark, you know. I mean, maybe in the future, maybe they do want to ride the Stark, or maybe they do something like that. But I mean, shit, I mean, they all, you know, they all had the opportunity, I would assume, right, to get, you know, I mean, maybe some of the guys, you know, that have, you know, like a Yamaha deal or a Cowie deal or something like that, maybe they were kind of pissed off. But I mean, I feel like it's already a level playing field, you know, like, hey, you had the opportunity, you could have got a Stark and you could have competed with a Stark. So like at that point, you just kind of got to lock your lips, you know?
I love your explanation there, Chase, on like Patrick's explanation of what the gyro does, because this was the question that I've been wanting to ask ARay, because we were talking about it in our group message, that panic rev that everybody does to bring that whip back around, and you hear it when they do the TV broadcast, and in person it's even gnarlier. So ARay, what's it like when he has to rev it and there's no sound to bring it back?
Yeah, that's another thing too. Like Samantha was standing right next to me. She's like, I get it, the whip's big, but it you lose the excitement because you don't even know whenever he's coming. A few times we almost missed Patrick going because we couldn't hear him. Right. And that's whenever we were in the group text. And I believe it was you, Chase, that said he should have put the FMF thing on the bars where you could sort of hear it.
Yeah.
But going back to like the whole 80 horsepower, and you said he was at 55, you can tell whenever you replay it back, as soon as he gets up to the ramp, he guns it, right? Like he pins it, and I guess he's holding the bike wide open while he's doing the whip. But as soon as like the whip's done with, he's letting off the gas. So maybe it's the, like the full like twist that he's using like the gas for, right?
Yeah.
Or the volts.
Dude, great timing too on that Patrick Evans show, because like full underdog going into this weekend. I know a lot of people that like watch freestyle and know Patrick's story from the last 5 years have known he's a ripper. But I mean, for us to put that out there and then him to do that, I loved a celebration at the end. Even the crash was sick.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it was it was super cool. Everyone there was stoked for Patrick. You know, I mean, even like the other guys, like a few of the other guys. I mean, yeah, you're going to have some guys who are butthurt, but like, the amount of respect, you know, that he was given, you know, what he's doing is gnarly right now. Right. I mean, no one's taken it that far yet. So, I mean, yeah, it's definitely a changing of the guard. I feel like, you know, with the Stark, maybe moving forward, we see the guys go even bigger, which I don't have any idea how that would happen. But yeah, I mean, if I'm the other guys, I'm definitely getting Stark.
Some would say it's generational talent that Patrick.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, ARay, like the whole stuff with the Raja thing too. Like, I guess PH was pissed, you know, about the whole Stark thing. And like, you guys see like the back and forth YouTube or Instagram videos, which was whatever. Right.
I was hoping somebody was going to bust out a Sharpie. Just like old X Games back in the day, you know, just tag it real quick.
Yeah. Definitely.
Did you get to see any of the high jump stuff, ARay, the quarter pipe? Did you see practice, or did you even go look at the lip?
You know, just stuff from Instagram, you know, I mean, that's so gnarly. I mean, I seen that, you know, Tyler Behrman ended up having a crash there, you know, and it's a bummer. I would really like to see him go up against, you know, Corey Creed and Raja there. I think he would have done really well. I mean, those guys, they look up to this event every single year, and they go above and beyond, and they push the limits every single year. You know, these guys, they don't, you know, it's just like Eli Tomac showing up to Hangtown, Redbud, or anything like that. They go there to win. And these guys, they push the limit, and they're serious athletes, dude. You know, they might have fun, but they also risk their lives like nuts going over some of this stuff. You know, I wouldn't be caught dead freaking going up to one of those ramps. So, yeah, I mean, these guys are super talented on a motorcycle, and it's cool to see.
All right, best trick. I loved that cliffhanger front flip. I didn't know that he had that in the bag. That was a big one. And then everybody's comments online. Sorry about the tornado siren thing. But Harry Beek doing a double backflip, and that's like a bronze medal trick now. And even some people are tired of that trick. Like, oh, my God, that trick was from 14, 15 years ago. And it's like, yeah, dude, it's crazy. Yeah. The level,
it's almost to the point with best trick. It's like everyone's done almost everything. Mm-hmm. Right, to where it's either like, hey, like, do we just get rid of best trick, or do we see these guys really start to do something crazy and think outside the box and really, really go for it, you know, like see these guys get, maybe the guys next year show up with a Stark and they do a triple flip or something of that sort, right? You never know. So
They're definitely getting more technical, it seems like, with the judging, like really focusing on the form and like the extension and stuff, because they're all really, it's almost, are they at the limit now? Like, and to think of them doing stuff even gnarlier is kind of terrifying.
I mean, you're thinking about like, how would you even do a front flip on a motorcycle? And then now they're doing front flips, you know, with cliffhangers, you know, I think, was it Bink? Was it Bink? Bink was the one that won, right?
No, Jacko won.
Oh yeah. Sorry. Jacko. My bad. I got him mixed up. But anyways, Jacko, I guess he did the first one and his extension wasn't as good. And then he went in for a second run and he got like the full extension. So super gnarly, right? Those guys are nuts. Like, I think they might be sick in the head. So, I mean, who knows?
Jacko's bag of tricks is gnarly because he can double backflip like no problem. He does everything. Yeah. And then I love watching his Instagram because he does it all with the plane flying and the skydiving. Like, Jacko's got a couple screws loose for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Super cool event. You know, like I said, I mean, Eric Bernard's at the office right now too. So like, I mean, he always puts on a great event, no matter what, whether it's Straight Rhythm, X Games, Paris, Geneva, Bercy, like just, it's just always awesome, you know? So yeah, props to those guys. It was a great event.
And good O'Neill presence too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great O'Neill presence. You know, I mean, we had Raha there, dude. Raha was ripping, you know, I believe we might've had one other guy, I'm not sure, I had to look at the thing, but yeah, great O'Neill presence. I noticed TV time for Raha on Sunday, so that was good.
Wyo's no longer O'Neill guy, he's a One Industries guy.
Yeah, I don't know what happened there, but
that was like last minute.
Bummer to lose him, but you know, politics.
All right, in closing though, about X Games, how was Wiz?
Wiz was good, man. It was super quick. He only did a couple songs, but I heard that there was a surprise appearance for MGK on Saturday.
Oh,
I did see
MGK
that.
MGK was there. He was like a surprise appearance. So that was cool. Ended up missing that, but oh well, it happens. Bummer. Yeah. So what were you doing this weekend, Chase? Were you on the jet skis? You're on the stand up. It looked like you had the thing torn apart.
Oh no, that was my dad's. We have a top end that we need to do on that, unfortunately. And it's about a 10-week lead time on pistons, so that sucks.
Right in the nick of time, huh? Right before 4th of July.
Summer's over for him, unfortunately. Yeah. But no, it was a chill weekend for me. I actually spent like pretty much all of my free day yesterday at a tattoo parlor, which isn't the funnest, but it's all right.
See it.
Yeah, show it off. Let's see it.
My guy got blasted, dude.
Let's not done, it, dude.
Ink.
Can't show it. Not Sorry. Done. Can't show
no,
it.
No, that's all right. Look, come on, give us a sneak peek, dude. All right.
It's of my dog, my baby that I lost a couple months ago. There's like a little portrait of him. So
that's a beauty.
Even around the back too. Ooh.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh, that's gotta hurt, dude. I bet that right there, it hurt.
In the pit when it gets close to the pit, that doesn't feel good.
No.
But I couldn't complain because the guy next to me, he's laid down and I just see his feet and he's getting his neck done right here. Like second tattoo. Like he's got something small in his chest and then straight for the neck. And I just see his feet are just.
God like 30 bless. Minutes.
Yeah. Oof.
All right. Hey, do you want to give your tattoo artist a freaking shout out? Because come on, dude. I might have to go over there. I might have to get me some ink done
here. So he is. He's a mountain bike buddy. He does Don and I stuff. Let me get his Instagram out here right now.
Is it?
It's Fernando.
Oh, it's Fernando. Oh, okay. Yeah.
So Nando_Magana. He is in Corona, Southern California area. He's a badass. Yeah, he crushes it. He's done basically everything on me and Don. So cool guy.
Heck yeah. Yeah. And we've rode mountain bikes with the guy a few times too, dude. And he sends it down the hills. Yeah. Yep. He is not scared.
Yeah. He's cool.
Yeah.
All right. Definitely. On to the important stuff.
I mean, what's more important than what we just talked about?
Right. You know, tattoos.
Where do you guys want to start at? 250 class or 450 class?
Yeah. Let's go 250.
Yeah. Let's do 250.
All right. What'd you think? I just got to say this. I was standing, coming down that hateful pavement hill that leads into the basin at Southwick when 250 Moto 1 went off. So I watched the start from there. Everybody went wild when Hayden got the hole shot. Missed the first start of 250 Moto 2. Shout out Juju. Glad he's okay. Ooh. Just a concussion. Pretty much the same spot coming down the hill to watch the restart. I've never heard people get that wound up for that move on the start by Hayden. Oh my God. The whole hillside, everybody in Southwick lost their minds. And then look at how that moto played out from there. So it was great. 250 class continues to deliver.
Yeah, that second was phenomenal.
I just got one question. Who are the haters that Hayden's talking about on the podium? Because I feel like everyone thinks that everyone knows he can win. Everyone knows that he goes fast. So like, who are these haters?
I don't know. I feel like all of us in the media have pretty much like said this is his title to lose now, but there's still someone's still hating and building the fire, which I'm here for it because maybe it's
do you guys think like in his head he hears like one thing and he kind of twists it just for his own motivation, somewhat like someone like Michael Jordan, like whenever you like seen like the documentary, mm-hmm. he always talks about how he would like create these own rivalries in his head just because like that's what he had to do.
Yeah.
Do you think it's something like that where he's just like thinking in his head that he has a rivalry, even though like it's not there or something? I don't know, but
I think we've seen this with other champions like Webb. He loves to almost build like a little bit of a
hype
enemy throughout this championship, right? And I think Hayden's just because he's younger, he's trying to
feed be into more it.
Talkative about it. Yeah, feed into it a little stronger, maybe.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I guess you would say a lot of people did say like, hey, this is Hayden's, you know, like if he's not going to do it here, you know, like this is pretty much like the only spot, right? Like this is like his weakest track because he's been vocal about not being the strongest in the sand, still gets the overall. I mean, the dude's willing to learn. He's willing to put in the work. He's willing to, you know, do all of these things. He's willing to listen. I feel like that's what I see the most in him. Like he's thinking outside of the box with his training, with his mentors, right? I mean, he's getting help, you know, from Chad Reed. He's getting help from Swanee. You know, I mean, we've heard about, you know, this flat track guy, you know, helping him with, you know, flat turns. You know, I mean, we see him going and riding with Roxen. We see him, you know, staying in California. Everything around him is just the will to win, pretty much. You know, I mean, and from what I've seen and heard from everyone around him, it's like he's willing to listen, he's willing to learn, he's a quick learner, and yeah, I mean, when you put all those things together, you know, he's definitely, I mean, he's at the top right now, right? I mean, like I said earlier, I mean, Southwick was the one spot where he had a weakness, and yeah, it seems like he's overcame that, and yeah, on to Redbud.
Yeah.
And bro, it was almost like he was a local there. Like those 2 days of practice that they did last week. Everybody likes Hayden, you know, everywhere. Like he's got fans all over the place, but it seemed like all of the Massachusetts, like Masshole people really were about him this week because I think that they respected that he came and did his time. Like, hey, I know I'm not good here. I better get up there and figure it out. Did figure it out and then put on a show.
Yeah. From what it sounds like too, there's quite a few like locals that came out and watched Max and them ride that day or those 2 days.
Yeah. It sounds like it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And honestly, that's awesome. You know, like for him to be able to do that and for the team to be able to be willing to do that as well. I mean, you know, that's not cheap, right? I mean, I'm assuming that they didn't drive the semi all the way up there and then
they did
the semi back to Florida.
Oh, no, they didn't drive the semi back to Florida. They drove a box van up.
Oh, because
they needed to deliver Max's bike. They needed to deliver a 450 for Jimmy Dakotas. And then after that got done, then they drove that back down to Florida. So a little bit of logistics back and forth. And then, like we'd said, you know, like you said, ARay, he goes down to North Carolina and then rides with Chad too. So all over the map, not really like taking it easy and laying up, resting before Southwick. They were hitting it hard.
Yeah. And I think too, a lot of people were anticipating Max Hansen to just, you know, get on the podium and do this whole thing. But honestly, I mean, tough day, shit the bed right there. I mean, I think he mentioned in some of the post-race stuff that he just missed the mark with the bike on, I believe, gearing, I think is what he said on like the Pulp MX show or post-race, whatever, or Vital MX, who knows. But yeah, I mean, you know, it was definitely tough. A lot of people had him on their fantasy team. I know I did. And then, yeah, I think we got like a whopping 11 points or something. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you know, it's racing's tough, man. You can't, and it's also tough for Anstey, right? Like just to jump into a series, you know, four or five races in when he hasn't been racing, right? I mean, that's another thing that's definitely tough on his end. You know, it's just, yeah, I guess the first lap he got cleaned out, and then I guess everyone's seen on the broadcast that he had something stuck in his rear wheel, so that was a bummer. You know, second moto, I guess crappy start, and then he just couldn't work his way up. You know, I think he got up to 10th or so, but I mean for everyone saying like, hey, no doubt he's going to be on the podium, he's probably going to win, which I mean, he could very well do that, but I mean, it was a tall ask, I would say.
Yep. I think we're seeing really with this 2B class how important a start is right now too. I mean, it's a lot of guys, especially on a track like Southwick, it doesn't look real fun to be passing and climbing through the pack. I think the start is really, really important this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. I mean, because I mean, dude, with the sand, you know, I mean, maybe if it's dry, it doesn't stick as much, but whenever the sand is wet, I mean, as soon as you're getting roosted, you're having to throw tear-offs. I mean, we've seen guys, you know, throwing their goggles. We've seen guys out of tear-offs doing, you know, wiping their lenses, that type of stuff. I mean, it's pretty typical at Southwick. Personally, I think the last few times I raced there, I went with the roll-off system. But, yeah, I mean, it's always tough at Southwick. Southwick was actually one of my favorite places just because I don't mind the sand, and it's usually hot and brutal, and a lot of those guys get tired. So, I like Southwick. Southwick's super fun. If you can get a flow, like blasting a sand berm is just, it's always fun, you know. But it's definitely one of those more tougher tracks that a lot of the guys struggle at, for sure.
Before we get too far into it, we do need to talk about the star class and a couple of the technical things that happened with them on Saturday. Because, you know, Max was ripping, and then he has his fastest lap taken away because of a failed sound test. Mm-hmm. Jordan Smith has points docked after the race for a failed sound test. And then I sent you guys that picture. They brought Hayden's bike back down after 250 Moto 2, so after it should have already been an impound, and came down after 450 Moto 2 and did a sound check on it again because it was making some noise. I don't know if they can show it on the camera, but the last like three laps of that 250 Moto 2 battle, you can see that he's riding the hell out of it and that it is smoking.
It's smoking,
so it started making some noises. So they had to go through all that. Like the AMA guys were on it to make sure that he got tested, but everything was all clear. I talked to the star guys afterwards and they're like, yeah, he pulled it up to the podium. Everything was fine. We took it up to impound to fire it up again. And then it was making noises. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird. They struggled even Supercross season, actually. Like, a lot of the guys had fast laps taken during Supercross just because they failed sound and whatnot. So, definitely interesting.
Mm-hmm.
What's weird to me is because, like, they haven't done this really. Have they? Like, have they been doing sound testing?
Oh, yeah. They've been big on sound lately. Yeah. There have been a couple times where they've, at Supercross, if they didn't have a place to do it, like a quiet, you know, if you're going to be backed up against the wall or a garbage container or whatever, you can't. But they were on it this weekend, and they've been very adamant to make sure that it's done. And then, you know, there are so many variables on a bike, too. It's not just the exhaust that you're looking for, because something rattling around or a loud intake, I mean, that's just going to add to the overall decibel of it.
Yep.
So, interesting facts there. And then it even got the 250B group fastest qualifier, too. It sounds like his fastest lap got deducted. So then Tom Guillon.
He was like 50th, yeah.
Yeah.
And so do you think the sound testing really like set the tone for the day? Do you think
set the tone for the day
with Anstey? Do you think that's kind of what ruined his day there a little bit with him losing that fast lap?
I wouldn't say that, because I mean, just to get in a crash, like opening lap chaos of Southwick, I think it's just hard to bounce back from that ever, you know. Yeah. But I think that there was something that they sent out, the pre-race note package, the SMX people did last week. And when you go look at past results at Southwick, it's really rare to see somebody, especially in the 250 class, go 1-1 on the day. You know, everybody typically does have a good one moto and then a not so good second moto. So it was just kind of par for the course on Saturday, it seemed.
Wait, so you said that didn't even make it in? Because they talked about it on Pre-Stay Live.
Yeah, Tom Gyan made it in, but the guy that had the fastest lap on the first session, like when 250B group went out, when the track was just dialed fresh, glass smooth.
238 or something, yeah.
Yeah, he got his fastest lap.
Gustavo or Gabo or something?
But he didn't have like that. He didn't have
his second one was like significantly slower.
Mm-hmm. It was like 56th.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That sucks. I didn't know that. Damn.
And then shout out Tony LaRusso too.
What was his like Anstey? Where was he at qualifying wise? Before he lost his fast lap.
Honestly, I couldn't tell you. I can just tell you this.
That's why I was saying like maybe it set the tone, because maybe he was second or third and he would have had a lot better of a gate pick versus.
Oh, he would have had a lot better one. Yeah.
Yeah. Because... So maybe that's why I was saying like, hey, maybe it set the tone for the day. He had a worse gate pick and then he got caught up in the stuff. And then, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And he was just like fighting from the back from then.
I was watching practice one live timing. And when they went through second lap, so first full lap when you're really on it, and they go through sector one of the timing loop, like shocker, Max Anstey's name goes up first and it's the fastest one there. So I'm just watching sector times, who's doing the fastest. And yeah, Max was ripping on Saturday.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
he'll finish the year out with them. I think next week could be just as good. I mean, he's been good at Redbud before. And
and
Redbud's sandy. I mean, it's fairly sandy, you know, it's got some deep spots, you know, and super gnarly. Yeah. I mean, I think give it a couple weeks, you know, I think he'll really start to put some results on the board, maybe this weekend. And then definitely like a track like Millville, Euros always do good at Unadilla. So, I mean, yeah, he's got some good races coming up that are pretty strong that he might be good on the team for. So, mm-hmm. I mean, I think this is good for Star because they haven't had that good of a season. You know, Jordan Smith, he's had the speed. He's, you know, he's been one of the fastest guys. If you look at the lap times, he's just not put himself in the perfect position, right? Like he hasn't been able to get off the gate. So hopefully he turns that around. But I mean, other than that, a lot of the other Star guys have been really struggling, you know. Nick Romano, he's getting good starts, but
yeah,
he's hanging on. He's hanging on, dude. I mean, he's getting better each week. We got to remember that, you know, he was hurt a lot of years, you know, and he wasn't able to race, but you can tell that he's starting up front. His speed is getting better. He's staying up front longer. But, you know, I mean, you guys know as well as I do, whenever you're trying to take that next speed jump, you stay there for as long as you can. But it doesn't matter how good a shape that you're in. Whenever you're trying to make that next speed step, you're still going to get gassed out and you're still going to go backwards, you know. But props to him for, you know, getting the good starts, running up there as long as he can. You know, that's awesome.
Yeah. Jordan Smith, while you mentioned him, I mean, he was ripping, dude. Like, again, bad starts, but he had one of the fastest laps, I think, in the second moto. He was on it all day.
Yeah.
Bro, I had no idea he got top five overall until I looked at the results later because he was just so quiet all day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, in that second moto, I mean, if you look from I think 10 minutes in, from like fourth place to 10th, they were just in a knockdown, drag out freaking battle, right? Everyone was just like back and forth, getting roosted. Like just, it looked gnarly in the 250 class there for quite a bit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Moto 2, Joe and Tom having their scrap there for a while too, and Joe getting the win there. So what did that look like on TV for you guys?
I mean, dude, typical Joe, like just shows up when you least expect it. He qualified, I think like 23rd or something. Like, horrible qualifying, and then just finally gets a good start and he's running the pace, and we're halfway through the season and Joe grabs a moto win. I mean, and he's heading to Redbud. He loves Redbud, so I'm stoked for him. I think he really, really needed that to hopefully get some momentum going in this championship. And on the other hand, dude, I can't believe Tom let that one go. I thought for sure that was his, you know.
Mm-hmm. Said he got sand in his goggles?
Yeah, I think he dealt with a couple lappers that were riding his way and got sand in the goggles, it sounds like.
Yeah, that's a bummer, man, because, like, you think, you know, you think Tom Vial, you think he's a Euro, he's good in the sand. Coming in, we all know is Hayden Deegan's like worst race, supposedly, even though, I mean, he still gets overall, but it's like, if you're Tom Vial, you have to win right now. Yeah. I mean, there's a huge gap, you know, like, I mean, you're getting paid to win. I'm sure there's pressure, you know, from KTM, the higher ups, like, hey, like it's time. So yeah, I mean, it's definitely tough. But it looks like Hayden's kind of running away from this thing right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's got a huge, huge points gap and it's only getting bigger.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah. Jalik's mechanical in the first moto. I know that so many people are going to think that's like, oh, new bike, overheating, we're at Southwick. It's the first time as a component failure. It's not something that they're in control of. So bike didn't break because it got overworked. It was something else. So I had to put that out for Triumph.
I had this conversation with a couple guys yesterday that are in one of the group chats I'm in. They're like, ah, Triumph's another mechanical. They said another bike blew up. And I don't think... I don't think they've had any bikes blow up though. I think first two things we saw were just all electrical stuff. They just whatever issues they had, but it wasn't the motor. And then obviously this was the chain. So definitely out of their hands.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how long has Honda been making motorcycles? Yeah. And Joe Shimoda had a bike failure this year in Supercross, you know? I mean, everyone has them. Star has them, you know, it's just part of the game, right? So he's been a sleeper, I feel like, this entire year. Like Jalik has just been a solid he's just been a solid like 4, 5, 6 guy. I don't know about 4, but like 5, 6, 7, like that whole range, he's just been solid the entire year. It's been a huge step up, I feel like, for Jalik, you know. I think he's really gelling with the team, with the Triumph. I'll give them props where it's due. I mean, I know I'm an O'Neill guy, all that stuff, but the Renin gear does look good on the bikes, man. It does look good. Like that whole setup, it looks really good.
Yeah, they're doing a good job.
On the X Games topic, Axel's Renin gear looked hot too. I love the flames.
Yeah, that was pretty sweet. Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm gutted for Jalik though. I mean, I think he came into the weekend tied for 5th or 6th in points. And like you said, he's just been quietly consistent. And that's not something we've seen from him in the past. And then obviously this is kind of out of his hands, and it's back to, I think he's back in 8th in points now or something. So big bummer, but I'm sure he'll continue to improve and put up some consistent results in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. So we're like 5 rounds in, right?
Mm-hmm.
I would say. Yeah. 5 rounds in the outdoors. Who is underperformed and who's overperformed, like, for you guys? Like, I mean, excluding Deegan, obviously he's overperforming right now, but
I'll go first so I don't seem like I'm copying anyone, because I think these are the popular ones. Savacci, just all the hype coming in, I thought he would have been on the box by now. Obviously, someone has been out of his hand, but dude, lots of not great starts and just not been in the position to have success. I think this weekend was a lot more similar to Paula, which is maybe what he needs, like a fresh start, because for a while it wasn't looking great. And then overperformed is for sure Chance Hymus. I mean, dude, he's ripping right now. The second moto, his sprint speed at the end was ridiculous, dude. Ridiculous.
Yeah, it was good. Yeah. Really good.
Especially after being buried early. Yeah. Chase just took my overperform, which is Chance. So I'm going to have to give me a minute on that. I hate to put him in there, but Levi is the underperforming after such an early start to the year, and just the excitement that was there. And I think after that weekend off, all of us were like, all right, it's a Chance. He'll get back in it. Yeah. Like, we're going to get a minute. Yeah. We're going to get this. And it just unfortunately never materialized on Saturday for him.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, like, I like Levi's just whole story right now, because, like, within everything, we keep talking and talking about the personalities and everything of the 250 class, but he's got this, like, real cool thing that people are going to gravitate to. And even if he does just finish top 5 this year in the outdoor championship, that's good. But mm-hmm. I think just, like, the groundwork that he's laying out right now for next year, the year after that, 2 years, 3 years from now, I think is pretty good, because it's his first chance to really break out and become himself, but it's also coming with its own setbacks and challenges as they are right now. Because Chase took Chance. That's a hard one. That is a hard one.
You say Master Pool.
Yeah, Master Pool. Because honestly,
I'm blown away by Ty.
Just because of everything that we've seen over the years, I think that there's just enough of a body of work where you're just like, there's always something that keeps it from all the way coming together. And now it's coming together quite regularly. And Ty's got it in him for sure.
Yeah. Let's see. I'm going to go underperformed Pierce Brown. You know, I mean, I'm assuming on the gas, he's like the team leader. And he's been invisible almost, right? The entire season. I mean, I'm sure he gets paid to win. We've seen in Supercross, he's got the speed. He's got good qualifying times. Whenever it comes down to the race, I don't know. I think he had a better weekend this weekend. Where was he overall this weekend? Was he like six?
I think he was sixth or seventh overall, but he was good. He was good.
Yeah. No, he was definitely ninth overall. He was definitely better this weekend. Oh. But I what was he?
Ninth.
Yeah. Yeah. I just think, you know, for how many years he's been in the class, I think that he definitely needs to be up there with that lead group. Right. I mean, I don't think that, you know, Jalik or Ty Masterpool, those type of guys should be in front of Pierce. So, right. I mean, yeah, I'm going to go him. And then, overperformed. You guys sort of stole my Masterpool thing, but, shit. I had to look at the results. I need to look at the results. All right.
I'll let you have Masterpool because I'll give Mark Finesse a shout out because Marky Mark has been doing very good. So you can.
Yeah.
Go on about Masterpool because I think Mark has been doing well because there was no real expectation for him. And although he had a mechanical in Moto 2, he got 14th in the sand at Southwick in his first visit there. That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I think so too. All right. So what do we think? 450 class? Or is there anything else you guys want to touch on?
We got to touch on the club bikes.
Yeah, we do need to talk about that because they were very open about what happened.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that red flag restart. You know, it's the sand of Southwick. We all talk about that all the time, but then Club added some cooling fans onto their bikes just to keep everything going. When the red flag happened, I guess that the fans were still running and it drained the bike's batteries and they didn't have anything to refire them. So both Jet Reynolds and Mark's bike, both just crapped out because there was no power for them. So like learning lesson, I think it's the same thing as the Triumph deal too. When you're building these bikes, like to the limit, there's always something crazy that you never can factor in of like what's going to happen. You know, we always joke, like think like, oh, the engine's going to blow because it's tuned to this or something, but it's the weirdest stuff that happens that you never think about that take guys out of consideration sometimes. So that's what happened with the club dudes.
Dang, that's a bummer. They need to hit up Firepower for some better batteries.
Yeah. I think, or just like Mike Bonacci, he added in the press release, he's like, we've just never run through a red flag scenario where we had to think about what it would do to the bikes. So that's something that they're going to learn from here. And we know other teams that have had that happen. Think about how many teams had spokes get ripped out of wheels and had nothing but T-handles and regular wrenches for years in their pit carts. And now everybody's got a, you know, lithium battery powered socket set or, you know, driver set there.
Remember the chain gate a couple years ago? Where
that
was ridiculous.
anything else?
I talked to Juju a little bit yesterday. It sounds like he's all good. I don't know. It sounded like he was like talking to him that he was going to be good for next weekend, but his Instagram post made it sound like maybe not. So
he'll be the doctor today.
Yeah, he seems good.
Yes.
Did not know why he was in Southwick. Did not know he was at Southwick. Had no idea of any of that going on, but he's all good. So that was nice to hear. It was a definite tense few moments because they came flying up the hill with him on the back of the Alpine Stars car. But then by the end of the night, the KTM guys are like, he hit his head. He's good. He'll be fine.
Yeah.
Oh, and
Dylan
Schwartz. Dude, I'll send a picture so you can put it on the screen if you want. But his, I'll just pull it up. I think Cochran hit him right between the goggle and the helmet.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, dude.
Oof. Dude, and still got up and scored points.
Not great.
Oh my God.
Dude.
Yeah, a little gnarly. But yeah, he still got up. He said, I probably shouldn't have continued riding, but oh well.
And then did the second moto too.
Yeah. Gnarly.
Gnarly.
You know, I just want to touch on this just because Southwick is like its own animal, right? You know, sometimes we'll see, you know, these guys come over from Europe and they'll race a few races. I mean, Jorgen Talbiku, I believe he's going to be out here for, I mean, we've seen him throughout all Supercross and all outdoors, but, you know, another good performance for him. I think he was 16th overall. So, I mean, that's awesome, right? Just another privateer out there grinding it out, you know, and just, I mean, dude, the sand track's gnarly. So a lot of these Euro guys are really good at the sand. So should be, you know, I mean, it was a good weekend for him.
I got to give my guy, Russell Bakari, a shout out. Thanks, Russell, for doing that privateer profile that's on our YouTube now. But he was at High Point last week, and he's on a KTM, and I saw he had, like, the Screaming Eagle for Bill Dill's 3D Racing on there, and that caught my attention. And then he's a Massachusetts local, so he was part of Media Day on Friday, so we started talking about all of that. You can watch that interview in Newsbreak. But he's this 18-year-old kid that just graduated a few weeks ago. This was his second ever pro national. He's really only been trying to be serious about racing the last, like, 3-4 years. He was on a Super Mini 3 years ago. Damn. And he's scoring points in his second national at the hardest track. So shout out to Russell for that one.
It's crazy how many late bloomers we are seeing these days. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I just feel like that wasn't as big of a thing 10 years ago, but there's a lot of fast kids that are hopping on bikes real late in life.
Yeah.
Maybe you don't got to go out there and get a PETA right away, parents. And play football for a little bit or something.
Anything else, boys?
I think that's it for 2D class.
Okay. All right, let's take a commercial break, and then we'll come back for more of the Kickstart Podcast from Southwick.
Hey, what's up, guys? It's Cooper Webb here to tell you all about Alpha Motocross Dynamics, an online training and fitness program that Brandon Hartraft and I have created. We wanted to develop a program to help riders who can't afford the cost of training facilities or riding coaches at the track. We've got 3 programs to help all riders from beginner to pro, and from full-time racers to weekend warriors and even vets. Whether you need help with riding technique, motocross fitness, mental strategies, or diet and nutrition, we have affordable packages to suit every budget. Check us out at alphamotocrossdynamics.com.
X-Brand Goggles was launched in 2008, and over the past 2 decades, they've earned a reputation as one of the elite eyewear choices in our sport. The newest offering, the Lucid Goggle, features an XDO injection molded lens for exceptional optical clarity, as well as superior protection against the massive roost that modern day 4-stroke bikes throw. At Swapmoto Live, we love the Lucid Goggle for its huge field of vision. Check them out at xbrand.com. That's eksbrand.com. If you're on the West Coast and you're looking for a one-stop shop, you need to visit the guys at STR Motorsports, formerly known as Shock Therapy Racing. With over 30 years of experience, your bike will be in great hands. Whether you're looking for a custom performance suspension revalve or just a basic rebuild, they've got you covered. STR also offers motor building services. Whether you need a stock engine rebuilt or a full-blown race motor, they're the place to go. Conveniently located in Wildomar, California, they're very close to Lake Elsinore and Paris Raceway. Additionally, they maintain a full stock of oils, tires, and tubes. They can get pretty much anything you need. Check them out at shocktherapysuspension.com.
Bill's Pipes has been producing championship-winning high-performance exhaust systems for all types of off-road motorcycles since 1974. Whether you're a mini racer or simply a premix burning diehard, our 2-stroke pipes and silencers deliver unbeatable performance gains. Our 4-stroke exhaust systems provide affordable performance gains and are available for motocross, off-road, ATV, and side-by-side applications. Best of all, every product from Bill's Pipes is produced and assembled in the USA. Check us out at billspipesusa.com.
Did you know that in addition to being some of the coolest people on motocross, the crew at WUSA are the official importers of Talon, Kite, and Edge hubs, as well as the leading resource for DID and Excel rims. Through the years, we've tested plenty of aftermarket wheels, and the wheel building crew at WUSA can't be beat. WUSA is the source for all things associated with wheels, including sprockets, spoke wrenches, tire irons, and more. Mention Swapmoto Live when ordering anything from WUSA and get a nice little discount too. Check them out at WUSA.com.
Hey guys, it's Ryan Villapoto. Now that I'm living the retired life and not bound to factory team sponsors, I'm able to choose my partners when it comes to building my bikes. I choose Backyard Designs to create my motorcycle graphics because they do a great job. Their kits look great, go on easy, and last long.
Packyard Design has the most comprehensive and user-friendly graphic website in the sport. Use the discount code SWATMOTO at checkout for a discount at backyarddesignsusa.com.
G'day guys, this is 9-times X Games gold medalist Jared McNeil. Off the motocross bike, I spend plenty of time cross-training on my intense mountain bike. From the super fast and efficient Sniper cross country bike to the aggressive Primer and Tracer trail bikes, or even the amazing Taser e-bike, every intense is designed and developed in the United States and built to the highest standards. A life on two wheels certainly includes pedals too. So give the crew at intensecycles.com a look.
What's up? This is Christian Craig. As a motocross racer, being in top physical shape is a must, and my favorite way to train is cycling. And whether it's road biking or mountain biking, I rely on Roy Cyclery to keep my bikes in perfect running order.
Roy Cyclery has been servicing Old Town Upland, California since 1962. Mention the Swapmoto Live podcast for additional discounts in the show.
Guts Racing, the leaders in seat technology. Go to gutsracing.com today and design your custom seat cover. We try to ship all custom seat covers within 36 business hours. We also offer free shipping to the lower 48 states. Once again, that's gutsracing.com.
Over the past 40 years, EVS Sports has established themselves as the leaders in innovation and technology when it comes to designing protection gear for today's motocross riders. Athletes like RJ Hampshire, Kyle Chisholm, Axel Hodges, and Travis Pastrana all wear EVS when they race, ride, or whatever Travis decides to do that day. Check out EVS-sports.com to gear up like the pros.
Thanks for sitting through the commercials. We're back with the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. All right, 450 class. Well, I mean, usually we talk like we do some like shenanigans usually in this part. Yeah. So
I took the bait on Max Anstey that we already talked about. I took the bait. It was plus 500. And I was like, it's a good bet. And it wasn't a great bet. Lost some money there. So,
dude, bet online, dude. It's taking our money. I actually sat out this weekend just because it's Southwick. And I usually know how gnarly Southwick is. I should have got in there. I should have bet some money. I'm sure the Joe Shimoda picks were very good. So, missed out on that. But, we got it going on for Redbud. I feel like I might definitely do some money if there is something. I'm going to bet on Time Master Pool for a whole show.
Yep.
Yeah,
I do like how the odds change.
Yes,
like from early in the week to later in the week, I do like how the odds change. So it does reward like being quick, mm-hmm. but then also as the week shapes up too.
Yep. And then, ARay, have you been able to ride your bike yet?
I haven't.
Oh,
dude. I mean, we've just been busy. You know, like X Games was this weekend. Just golly, I don't know. Just can't find the time, seems like,
we've recently built up a Husqvarna FC350 for Mr. Pat Lopez, and he is equipped with the same Race Tech spring conversion that I believe you have or are going to be getting. Mm-hmm. And from what it sounds like, he's extremely like stoked with his bike after two rides. So that's pretty cool to hear about.
Awesome. Yeah. He's been up at Mammoth all week, pushing the OGO stuff, up there. So, I'm going to try and give him a call this week, sort of ask him about it, because I'm stoked, dude. I can't wait to ride my Race Tech stuff. Cannot wait. It's going to be good. Yeah.
Shout out Race Tech. I'm going to do an inner monologue today. That's overdue. I was going to do it yesterday. My flight got delayed. So there'll be one of those coming.
Yeah. Heck yeah.
All right. 45.
When are you going to ride? Hold on. Tour de France, ARay. How's this tour fever? Oh.
Tour fever's good. I was able to watch a little bit of it over the weekend. I haven't been like fully into it every day, but I did see that Romain Bardet, he made a comeback. He was able to win a stage, which was good. I mean, dude, the state, like stage one was so gnarly this year. It's crazy. They had like six gnarly climbs. It seemed like it was hot. Mark Cavendish was struggling, he was struggling to stay off, and I don't know. Did he make the time cut?
Yeah, he did. Just barely. And dude, was barely ripping today.
I mean, his whole team had to go back for him. It's tough. You know, any sprinter, you know, they're not built for climbing, you know, so it's, you know, those super long days in the saddle, especially for day one, just to, you know, be just right in there, you know, climbing each day. It's definitely tough. Right. So, I don't know. I think it's going to be a great tour. It sucks that, their champion from last year, he was hurt. He's coming in a little hurt, which, you know, I mean, he may not be up to full form, but I think, you know, the favorites are, you know, obviously, you know, going to rise up to the top as soon as we get later in the stages. So, yeah, I'm excited. It's going to be fun. It's going to be good.
How about all the arrow? Did you see the arrow nose piece on the glasses now?
Just all of it, yeah.
It's like a 3D printed thing that goes onto the sunglasses and then goes over the nose. So it looks like a bird beak. And then now teams are testing square water bottles instead of round. So then the air goes over those better. It's crazy.
It's nuts. Like, it's just changing. Nuts. Like, I mean, it's each year they're learning and experimenting. It's going to be crazy.
Did you know they have a rule on the socks chase? Like, there's a mandatory length that they have to be because there's an aerodynamic advantage if it's too low or too high.
Mm-hmm. Do they have any regulations on body hair?
I don't know about that, but I think it's pretty standard. Everybody's just
Many of those guys do you think are doing that new razor that we've seen on Zacho's Instagram this past week for men?
I need to look at that thing.
Yeah. They have like a razor for men. Like,
is it like a full, like straight, like razor?
Yeah, I mean,
it's not just a trimmer.
No, it's a razor.
Yeah, it looks like a Venus.
I can't do that.
You know? Yeah.
I can't shave.
I get too many ingrown hairs.
Yeah, I can't shave mine.
I actually shaved mine this week.
I see them.
Smooth.
Jeez. I did mine this morning. I'm ready to go hit the tour. I'm ready to do it today.
Way with that better muscle definition.
All right, people are really going to clip off of this. So
they're already gone.
Way gone. All right, 450 class. Moto 2 was nuts. Moto 1 was great. And I think we really do have a battle on our hands for these next few weeks because Jet's hurting at the end of the day. Not hurting, but Jet's tired. Like, even when I went by the Honda truck to ask him for an interview after the weekend, he's like, do I have to? And I was like, well, you never have to. And he's like, I'm tired, Anton. I don't want to do it. I'm like, you don't have to do it. But homeboy is definitely using different parts of his body because his shoulder is a question. And I think we're only going to see that more and more. In the press conference, he said that they're probably going to actually have to go have an MRI to look at it. I wonder if
it's crazy. I can't believe they haven't already.
I wonder if they haven't either. But maybe it's like the Barsha thing. You don't go looking because you don't want to know. You just want to get through it.
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure they've gotten x-rays and all that type of stuff. They just haven't gone as far as like an MRI. Cause, you know, anybody knows MRI is like a full, like, it's a whole on deal, but I mean, x-rays, they can get x-rays right there at the track. But, tough. I think this shows that, you know, it's not over until it's over. Right. I mean, that second moto, I think it's going to give a lot of confidence to Chase, you know. I mean, the points are tight, you know. I know, Chase, like, I got your text, after the first moto of being boring. But then, you know, at the end of the day.
That was more so me just being lame.
Sleepy.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie to you. I fell asleep during the first moto too. But, you know, at the end of the day, whenever you look at after that second moto, I mean, Chase was on rails, right? I mean, for him to run a 2:16 that late in the day, that late in the moto, you know, it's nuts, especially there because of how much the track changes and how much slower the track gets throughout the day, right? And for him to be running the fastest lap time, like, of the race that late in the moto, I mean, he's just, I'm not sure. Anton, if you talk to him, like, was that the plan going in all day? Was that something, because obviously he did get dropped in that first moto. Was that his plan to sort of save a little bit of energy? I know it wasn't that hot there, but yeah, I'm curious what sort of his plan was. there.
Okay, so I didn't really get the chance to talk to too many people. There was a lot of late flights out on Saturday night, and then the rain that you guys saw starting during 450 Moto 2 was coming in harder and harder, so people were just bailing. Mm-hmm. So I didn't really get to see that many guys. But I will say that even if you watch that first lap, it looks like his overall intensity was 10 times higher.
Yeah.
You know, when he was behind Aaron and Justin Cooper and Jett and Hunter 1-2, and he knew he had to make that move, and he did it, got both of them right there very early in that lap, and then set off was good. And then just to watch as that race went on, because for a minute when Hunter got by Jett, I was like, okay, well, here we go. And after Chase had gotten dropped in that first one, I honestly didn't think he would be a factor as much in the second one. And so I was like, all right, now there's the day set. Hunter is going to get the win that so many of us have thought he was going to get. He's going to continue this red plate run that he's had. He's good at Southwick. We know that. This, and this. Jet's coming off what he's coming off of. And then Jett reeled him in. And as I was watching, I'm like, oh, Jett's going to get him. But then after he got him, I had no idea that Chase was going to put on the charge that he put on. Watching how much of the track he was moving, going everywhere, not just sitting behind him, not just sitting behind Jett, trying to make things happen. And I agree with what you said, ARay. When he did finally make that pass, I watched the big launch happen out of the hole down that flat ski jump. People were losing their minds. And just to see it all happen and his aggression and how he took off after that, I think that's a turning point for the year, because even fans around me on the track were like, he hasn't done that yet. He hasn't caught and passed Jett outdoors yet, period. It's on now. And yeah. I think universally, you could just feel the vibe in the entire area change. Like, oh shit, we have something now. Sick, let's do it.
I wonder if he's learning like a new way he's going to have to start racing. And like we know he's got ridiculous sprint speed. He's really, since Hangtown, he's had faster laps. It's just been little mistakes here and there. And I wonder if this weekend he kind of realized, hey, if I don't got it right away, I'm able to chill and find areas of the track that I'm better at, and then put in a push at the end, because he has the pace. And especially with Jett hindered by his shoulder right now and getting tired from using his legs too much, I think he's really got the ability right now to put in a late charge and snatch him up if he gets a decent start.
Mm-hmm. The only thing that, I mean, I'll agree 100%. The only thing is, I feel like each week Hunter is getting better and stronger, which I don't know if it was tired, if he was tired at all in that last little bit of that moto, or what was going on. He was making some like crazy mistakes the last two laps, and, you know, he was getting in and, you know, lappers were getting in his way and that type of deal. But I'm wondering if, like, you know, any of like the mechanics, you know, relate any of the messages to him, because like, if he would have passed Jett in that second moto, then that would have gave Chase their overall. Right. But if he didn't pass Jett would have still gotten the overall. And so, like, I don't know. Do you think that played any factors of it all, Anton? Mm. Like, hey, like,
I don't know, because don't pass like Jett.
We still want to get the overall. We still want to, like, you know.
I would need to look at like what the actual margins between those guys were, between Jett and Hunter, in that last little bit. But
because
from where I was watching on the track, they were close, but it never really seemed like there was like, oh, he's going to get him. And it did kind of happen. So late, like, Chase's pass coming on, and I think it was like 6-7 minutes to go. You know, I think that had pretty much kind of set what things were there. But then I think another thing that, you know, we don't really talk about that much is, how does Chase race those two guys differently? You know, individually, you race them different than you race everybody else, but then you have to race each of them differently than you do, because there's this level of respect and this question of like, how am I going to get around Jett? But with Hunter, no disrespect to Hunter, but I think people are like, oh, I'm going to get Hunter. I can pass him. I can make this happen, because I haven't had as many scraps with him yet. So like, even that pass that he made on him where he goes by the front wheel really close, I don't think that Chase does that to Jett as often. I think he can get away with it a little bit more on Hunter as they figure it out. But I think in the next few weeks, you'll see Hunter be like, well, no, you're not going to do that to me. I'm going to go do it to you now.
I think
like,
we already saw that. Well,
Hunter, Hunter doesn't take any shit, dude. Hunter's not going to take any shit from anybody. Especially, I think it's like,
Yeah,
I mean, we all seen, like, you know, the beef between him and Anderson. So like, he doesn't take any shit, and he's like, yo, dude, like, nah, you ain't messing with me.
But you know what I mean? Like, I don't think enough people have had incidents, but like, they haven't really raced Hunter with that. You know, in his 250 class career, he did have big leads most of the time, where he's racing younger kids.
These this time last racing year, it was him and Styles Robertson.
Yeah.
Remember that? Yeah. So. And neither one of them were backing down either. So, I mean, Yeah. I mean, I think Hunter is definitely spicy whenever it comes to like aggressive riding, you know. I mean, he's like not going to let any of that stuff like get past him, you know? So that's super cool. And then, yeah, like I said, he's just getting better each week. Right. So that's something that Chase is going to have to really, you know, manage, if he's wanting to win this championship. Right. You know, I mean, I still feel that Jet and Chase are the two best guys, but I mean, each week it just looks like Hunter is getting better. He's getting faster. He's getting stronger. So, yeah. And he's really, really taken, you know, that 450 like strong, like he's just riding it really well. If I'm Chase Sexton though, like I got to figure out a way to get off the gate. You got to get in front of those two, you know, I mean, they've been perfect off the gate, and it's just each moto Chase is having to be absolutely perfect to get up to the wheel or, you know, and to get past him, right? You know, each race, he's having to work his way around him, you know?
At least beat Phil off the gate. If he can do that, yeah. Then he's third.
I mean, come on, you know?
Bro, there was no beating Jet off the line in that second one unless you came fucking rolling down the hill already in fifth gear before they dropped the gate, because I watched. I had the camera focused on
pictures,
him. He was my focal point. He was half a bike length ahead of everybody just the first, before the rear tires even got all the way over that metal, so he had that one dialed. One thing I will ask you, and like both of you can go with this. We've seen these really gnarly pushes that Chase has been able to put on three times now at different races in the late motos. Like Hangtown was good four times really now. Hangtown, High Point, I'm missing one. Fox Raceway, and then this week, yeah. So four of the five races that we've had, Thunder Valley you just got to cross out because that was just a terrible day overall. Yeah. But I wonder if he's starting to figure out how he can channel that intensity more and more, especially in the second motos, and then learn where's the limit without making that mistake, because he had that intensity at High Point and then had the mistake where he fell, because that was the first time that he's really run Jet down and run with him and then had the crash.
Even Thunder Valley, we saw the intensity and then he crashed right before the finish line, mm-hmm. trying to make that pass. So yeah, I think you're on to something.
Did we see this many mistakes from Chase the year it was him and Eli going back and forth?
I don't think so. Like, I think there were a couple times where it was just like, oh, this could go a certain way, and then it didn't. But I also think those were more head-to-head duels where we really haven't had very many of him and Chase or him and Jet head-to-head yet.
Right.
A couple,
right.
But not as many as we had Eli, where that was like, every single weekend, you knew what you were going to get between those.
Yeah, that
two.
Was almost like a private, private race between just those two. That was.
It was nuts. Yeah, but I don't know. And props to AP this weekend.
Yeah,
I want to give him some credit. That second moto, dude, he hung in there, right? I mean, he was hanging tough, and yeah, I'm stoked for him because I mean, you think Southwick, you don't think AP is like setting the world on fire, but I mean, he was significantly better there, you know, and I think, you know, these next couple of weeks, he really likes the tracks that are coming up. You know, he's been good at Red Bud. He's been on the podium a lot of the years that he's raced it. You know, Millville's another good one for him too. So yeah, stoked for AP.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
On the visiting Euros thing, Kyle Webster came out, not a good first moto. Second moto was great though. And that salvaged the whole day. Kyle's Australian, so sorry about the Euro imports.
Is that that sponsor, is that your Reeves Tile sponsor overseas?
So that's like, you know, Boost Mobile.
Yeah,
that's like a subsidiary, I guess, an American subsidiary of Boost Mobile.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And they've been sponsored by them for a bit, so we need to look up the Mobile X thing, but you can get those phones at Walmart and everything like that. So that's a cool deal. It's an Atherton deal. And that was a good showing for Kyle.
Yeah, it sounds like he's doing a couple more, right? Or at least Redbud?
Redbud next week, and then Dino's in for next week. And then this is just building to try to put Kyle more on the focus of, like, he could be the next guy to come out of Australia in the next few years. They've tried a couple things, and he has raced more different stuff than just outdoor nationals down there over the last little bit. So I think there's, like, a push to make Webster get good.
And it sounds like he really wants to be the third guy, or the third option for MX Nations, too.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Speaking of... with that, sounds like the brothers are really going to stamp their passports up heavy this year between going to England, Paris, and then going home.
Yeah. And which, I mean, that Yeah. I mean, that's a lot of plans, you know, to really, you know, I mean, and you never know too about how this shoulder is going to be either. So you never know. You might see him not being at all those places. Right. And you got to, depending on how bad the shoulder is.
How good's that paycheck?
Yeah.
And you got a bike too, to worry about.
Pretty big paycheck, I think. Yeah. And a new bike. And they are going to have to go to Japan because of the Honda Champion Day thing. Like, they're going to have to go to that.
My goodness.
Yeah. 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 This weekend's going to be exciting. We're going to see a lot of new guys at the races that we haven't seen in a while. I mean, we got Tickle coming back. We got, we got Webster. We got Gert Krestenoff. I want to say something about Gert too, because he's obviously an O'Neill. Awesome dude. He ran out of gas both motos, and he did have a bigger tank. Yeah. So both motos, he stopped into the mechanics area to fill up with gas. Yeah. And I think he lost a couple positions. He was running 10th until like two laps to go or something of the sort, but yeah, it's super big bummer for Gert. I think he ended up getting, I believe, 13th. Not sure.
Is he on a Honda?
The results right there.
He's on a Honda.
Yeah. Gert Krestenoff.
Did he have that red moto tank? So like Red Moto is the Italy, like they're a, like Italy company, Italian company that makes a bunch of Honda parts. Yeah. And they have one because Jeremy Hand had it. And then I put it in Kickstart a few weeks ago because Marcellisi had it too. And it's like $400. Gotcha. It's a couple gallons bigger, but it uses all the stock fittings and everything. So it looks just like an OE part that bolts right in.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
A couple people had those this weekend. And then the Honda guys had big carbon tanks. Yeah, I mean, you have to have the oversized stuff, and next week too, because that's a fuel hungry track for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. How do we think Tix is going to do? Red Bud.
I say we see him around Mookie Craig. Well, maybe not Craig this past weekend, but if Craig's back to his normal self, I see him battling around the top 10.
Like 8-11.
Yeah.
Yeah. 8-12. Yeah. I think. Yeah.
I think he has a better second moto, to be honest.
Yeah.
Depending on how hot it is, you know, he's one of those guys. I mean, we know how Tix is. I mean, he's a hammerhead. He doesn't get tired. I don't think he knows what it feels like to get tired. So I see him having a better second moto than first moto. You know, this is a home track for him. It's a home track for AP. It's a home track for Chase Sexton. You know, it's a lot of the guys' favorite tracks. Ty Masterpool's always been good here. I think we're going to see some fireworks. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be good. You know, I think this is always the race each year that everyone always looks forward to. Best race of the year. I personally hate the track, but I mean, everybody else seems to love it. I think it's going to be great. What do you guys think? Who do you guys have for wins? I'm going to go Chase Sexton, you know, just, I think that he's really going to, dude, I think he's really going to, you know, put this championship on his back and take it home, you know, after this weekend. I think he's going to be good, you know.
Was it Red Bud that did Hayden's bike blew up last year?
No, that was Unadilla.
Yeah.
I'm going to say Chase, and I'll just say Masterpool to be fun.
Okay.
I feel like I do see Masterpool on the podium this weekend. Yeah. Yeah, just with confidence and everything like that, you know, just with what he's done there in the past and that type of gig. So, yeah, I see him on the podium. Anstey's still a question mark for me. Just depends, you know, that just shows, like, that second moto shows that it's the 250 class is so star dependent. There's so many good guys. You know, if you don't start up front, it's super tough unless you're Hayden Deegan, I would assume, right, to make it up to the front of the pack.
Weather's supposed to be good too. It's supposed to be like 85 on Saturday, and I think there's a chance of rain on Friday. So media day is questionable for Friday, it looks like right now. But I mean, 85 at Red Bud's beautiful compared to that one year where it was like 115. This weekend was awesome too, because I don't think it ever got over 75 degrees, and that cloud coverage that was overhead, it was perfect. That was like one of the most fun Southwick days I've had, I think, ever. I love that race. Hey Ray, like you said, you like that track, but that's a fun one to go to. Oh, you hate that track. You hate Southwick.
Oh, no, I love Southwick. No, yeah, I thought you were talking about Red Bud. I love Southwick. I hate Red Bud.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, we didn't have a hot weekend this weekend here. So, I mean, hopefully I feel like the guys would be more fatigued than drained, just with, you know, this weekend, this past weekend at Southwick, right? I feel like the track was more demanding on the body versus, like, you know, getting super drained, right? Because it wasn't super hot, but I mean, I'm sure the guys are going to be sore as hell today just from being up on their legs and that type of stuff. But I think they got lucky with it not being hot at Southwick with how gnarly the track was. Mm-hmm.
I have to say, I loved everybody going to Croom. I thought that was so sick. Yeah.
Do we know what happened to Anderson late in the moto? Because I obviously went down for Turner, and then I saw he was up to 12th, I think, at one point, but I think he finished like 30th or something in the second moto.
I'll check the press release 1 second.
Not good. Not good.
Mm-mm. Hey, a decent day for Andis and Jay Coop. He's another one who's just been ripping, you know, this entire year on the 450, first year full-time 450 guy. I mean, he's the complete package, you know. I mean, dude. When's the last time we got him on the SML show?
It's been a long time. He lives in Florida now, unfortunately.
Oh, that's a bummer. Well, next time he's out here, we definitely need to get him on the SML show. I'd really like to hear how he's doing, you know, just with the 450 and just transition wise, right? Like, what's different, what's the same, you know? And I mean, this is his first year full time doing, you know, all 31 races, you know. So I'd be curious to see like what he changed and made different, you know, on training wise and that type of thing.
Something interesting while we're talking about him, just like silly season wise, obviously. I think the big draw with Star keeping him that we've talked about is when Eli retires in 26 or whatever, they're going to probably wish they had still hold on to Jay Coop. Well, you mentioned something, ARay, and then I talked to a little bit more people, and it sounds like there's like full negotiations going on right now for gear deals for Hayden on a 450 in 2026 already. So that's another.
There was some truth to what I was.
Sounds like it, yeah. So that said, that means Jay Coop. I don't know if I see him a star now.
But hey, no, I wouldn't say that, because then the other thing that I hear so much about Hayden is like time to go start our own team.
That's sort of what I'm hearing too.
I mean, that's what I'm hearing.
2026 450 class. I feel like, you know, he can do a lot of good. I mean, he already has the monster. You know, I would assume he already has his own personal monster deal excluded from the team, right? I mean, it wouldn't be out of the question. I mean, Brian's done his own team before. I mean, hell, he was even a sponsor of the team, you know, whenever he was doing all the Metal Militia stuff.
They got Ford truck money.
Mm-hmm. You know, and they already have, you know, a couple of different sponsors, you know, than the team, you know, and I think with how marketable he is, I think that it might be smarter, like a bigger money deal if he were to do his own deal.
That's true.
So Chase, and ARay, that topic that we're talking about with his gear negotiation, and I was thinking about it hardcore all week.
Big number.
It's a big number. Actually, and it's, I mean, and it's,
I was talking to some guys out here, you know, just here in the office, and honestly, like over the time period, that whole deal, I mean, it's not that much, you know. Thinking Hayden Deegan and what Hayden Deegan is and what Hayden Deegan's following is, and like that whole deal, like the whole family aspect, all of that, you know, it's 100% doable.
I don't think the number is that big. I think it was more the time length that was big. But
I think what really got me excited about both of them was the two together, because like, it's both of them. It's the time frame and the number, because it's a long time and it's a pretty good amount of money for a kid. But use that as the selling point, like, rather than us like gossip about it and everything like that, talk about that, because that's going to be, if that deal goes through for whoever it is, because I know there's two companies that are going to do whatever it takes to get that
kid. whatever it takes.
And there are so many different perks between like, here's the bottom line number of like, this is what you're going to make. But as we've seen through other sports, and the kid's super marketable, you put a revenue share, a product share. I've sold this much. We're going to get this much of this. I have a signature line out there. You're going to get this cut of it. Even more money to be made. And that's going to make Hayden's worth even more big. But I think that go ahead,
Eric. And I just want to add to what you were saying, like over that 10 years, that's just salary based, you know, that we're talking about, you know, which it and for the listeners, it is a huge number, right? For X amount of years. But you got to factor in too. You got to factor in race win bonuses. You got to factor in championship bonuses. You got to factor in, you know, all of that type of deal. At the end of this 10 years or however long it's going to be, it could be a very, very huge number. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You know, just depending on his trajectory, his, you know, how well he does do on a 450 class. Like, I mean, it's a lot of money.
So what I was thinking about this as this all went along, they got to get in front of it. Don't hide it. Put that out there. Put that in the YouTube. Start having everybody talk about that, because that's just going to – we need contract speculation like this. We know, this guy's going to this, and that puzzle pieces putting it together, that's fun. That's interesting. But when you start to see some numbers behind it, and that's a group that has no shame in numbers – put it out there and watch everybody else around you have to now match that, have to match that energy, match that kind of excitement, match that kind of buzz, because it's just better for everybody. It's just going to make the sport seem bigger. So please put that shit out there as soon as like we get closer for them. Just keep kind of seeding that stuff out there so everybody has a reason to get excited. It's not just us goofballs.
Yeah. And with that being said, with I guess the Deegans being in that whole, you know, NASCAR thing where like everything's all out there in the open, everybody knows what everybody's making, right? Do you think with them, you know, with their marketing knowledge and all that type of stuff, do you think that they're going to get in front of it, like say on their YouTube channel? Do you think that they might actually say, hey, this is what's in the works, this is what's going on, like this is what we're trying to do?
I'm sure of it, but then you need to have other people pushing that narrative, not narrative, but pushing that message along a bit too, to have everybody excited about it. You know what I mean? Like they can say what they want
for the sport.
Huge. You know? Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I mean, this is a lot of money that we're talking about, you know, over a long period of time. This is something that I feel like could be, you know, on Barstool Sports, like, so-and-so ex motorcycle racer or like a motorcycle racer signs with a big major company for X amount of money. And it's like big. So
It's just, what we were saying, it's the time frame, the name, and the amount. You put those three things together and you just have that as a headline and that is a press release that gets sent out to ESPN. It's on.
And this gear company, to be fair, this gear company could actually, I mean, it could be worth it. I mean, can you imagine if Thor would have released like the collab gear that Hayden was wearing this weekend and he's worn every once in a while? Like that stuff would be gone in minutes.
Hey, so back to the Jason thing, because we hopped off that and I looked at the press release. He had a second crash late in Moto 2, and after that one, he pulled off. So he's like, I'm good.
Gotcha.
And so, then Barsha, sounds like that's it for Barsha for a little bit.
For a little bit, yeah. No surgery, but just definitely got to rest up his knees.
Yeah.
Which is a bummer because he's been building, but better that than have to be on the sidelines again for as long as he was last year. Cause last year was such a complicated deal with those collarbone injuries.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I just want to say AC's freaking debut, you know, for Trackside was awesome. Awesome. Yep. God, like the way he was talking about Chase freaking being built like a Mack truck, like what is a freaking so dude. Like me and Samantha were sitting on the couch, we were watching the race, and dude, she just starts busting out laughing. She's like, dang, you just did him like that. I was like, yeah, I mean, he's not lying. You know, I mean, he's that dude is not going to get tired, and he does look like a brick shit house whenever he's on the bike. Dude.
Him and JT are the perfect guys to do that grid walk on the starting line. Cause like I've said before, they know the guys that are chatty. They know the guys that are going to get locked in. So like, go talk to them. And it was cool to have AP on it too, and be just as excited for AC to have that chance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody was pumped for AC this weekend.
It's good. That's good.
Anything else, boys? Did we touch it all?
Did Marchbanks have a mechanical or something? It didn't look like he finished.
I don't know. I have to look. I think something happened. Oh, Marshall Welton. Did you see Marshall's side?
Oh,
yes. My God.
Oh, terrible.
Ouch. Ouch, ouch.
Yes. Full tread pattern all the way up the side.
Yeah. His helmet's sick. As
yes, prick. It does. who had the best gear this weekend?
Ooh. I really like Sexton's kit with the orange.
And the multicolored?
Yeah, I think that's pretty cool.
I'm biased, but I'm still Juju's kit, you know, although he didn't finish. I mean, he looked good.
Was he wearing this weekend?
He's wearing his white kit.
Okay, there's enough of that gear when you're going to put it in production.
Yeah, how much?
Like, clearly, you can make the stuff. So how much of it is out there? It's not in just size 28 pants.
None.
What do you mean?
It's all size 28.
Yeah, but how many kits? Because he told me he only has 3 and he's running it every round. There's no way he only has 3.
He's got more than 3.
I mean, I can guarantee you there's probably like 1 or 2 left, and that is it.
Okay. All right.
I like those vintage jerseys, ARay.
Yeah.
I do. Hey, those look sick.
Anton got a picture of Rod Bell. His kit looked kind of cool, too.
No, it was terrible. The mix match? No, fine him for that.
Oh, yeah, fine him.
From what I saw, it was just the back, and I thought it was like some new stuff because there was a red number, red pant. It's old.
It was a black jersey with red pants, and they just could work together, but it did not look good. Dude, yeah,
never mind.
He's a loose program, dude. I don't know, man. I don't know. But, you know, we do have our 2025 gear is actually dropping today. We should be having a post coming out here pretty soon. Yeah. So hopefully here in the next couple of weeks, we should have our 2020 or guys in the 2025 gear. So
when can I get, thank you for the hat, by the way, the new hat.
Oh, you're welcome. Do you need a 2025 kit?
Well, I've only got a couple brands to choose from right now, and I would love.
Okay. All right. We'll get you one. Yeah. So, dude, I mean, the new O'Neill 2025 gear line it looks great. You know, the design team did good. We got 2 new air colorways. I believe 2 hardware colorways, or no, 3 hardware colorways. I believe. Shit, I should know this. And then we have some new Mayhem kits, as well as, you know, obviously our youth stuff. But yeah, I mean, we're stoked on the way it came out, and it's doing really well for us. So we're stoked. Yeah.
Even if you weren't stoked with the way it came out, would you still be stoked?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So. No, right. I think this stuff looks great. I'm excited for it. It looks good. So, yeah. We'll have to have you check it out, and maybe you do a review on it or something.
Well, I'm taking over our Yellow Dad's vlog this week, so I'm trying to.
All right. Well, good. Let's do a feature. Let's do a feature on the new 2025 stuff.
I would love to.
All right. I'll send you some pictures after we get off the podcast, and see which one you want.
All right. Sounds cool.
I'm stoked. All right.
My boys, is that it? Did we do
it? I think that's it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Yeah,
parting words.
We miss you, Don.
We miss you, Don.
Yeah.
Hopefully he's not sick.
Red Bud.
Yeah.
God damn it. Why would you say that? I'm going to hear that so much.
I don't know. I hate it. Sorry. My bad.
I like the race, but man, at a certain point when you hear it, you're just.
That's like, the first time you've heard it. Yeah. This year. So like just keep that in your brain.
Rob's been hyping people up at the races. Yo, you got to go to Red Bud. He's been getting them ready. And then you have just somebody in the crowd that's like, got to.
Oh, and the moto memes too, who's like, he's singing in the shower, just saying Red Bud, like just practicing Red Bud in the shower. It's freaking awesome.
Yeah. I can bet that this weekend is going to be insane because 4th of July is Thursday and then Friday and then Saturday. So hopefully.
And everyone has the weekend off, you know, like everyone has a 4-day weekend who works. So like everyone's just going to be there and they're going to be shit faced and they're going to be. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. I don't think I'll see you guys next week. I just remembered I'll be on my way to Indiana for the Honda intro. So.
It just me and Anton next week carrying the show?
No, Don will be back. So he'll be on. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Cool deal.
All right, boys.
All right, everybody. Have fun this week. Don't get hurt with your fireworks as you celebrate the 4th of July. Make something good too. What are you putting on the grill?
Have fun responsibly.
Yeah.
What's that?
What are you doing for 4th of July? What are you going to do?
I don't know. I mean, Chase just goes to Havasu every year.
Yeah, I might try and do a day trip to Havasu or Needles real quick. We'll see.
I don't know what I'm going to do yet. I might go up to Santa Barbara, have a beach day. I don't know. You know, either that or, you know, who knows? I haven't really decided yet. We need to figure it out quick, though.
It's my dog's birthday, so I'm going to make him a cake.
Nice. Oh, heck yeah, bro.
Yeah.
All right. Well, hey, you guys have fun. You guys have a safe 4th of July weekend.
Happy 4th.
Happy 4th. All right. Thanks for watching this episode of the Kickstart Podcast presented by ProTaper. See you guys soon.